ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमः ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिन्निति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्णा हरे हरे, हरे रामा राम रामा हरे हरे। वी हैव बीन डिस्कसिंग अबाउट सैक्रिफाइस। सैक्रिफाइस कैन बी परफॉर्म्ड according to the acquired nature of a person in mode of goodness or passion or ignorance. Accordingly, the sacrifice will differ. The actual external rituals may not be different, but the aim or the purpose can be completely different for the same external rituals. So in the 17th chapter entitled The Divisions of Faith, Lord Krishna explains that according to the acquired nature, every person has got a particular kind of faith. Shraddha. In Sanskrit, the word is Shraddha. So the faith or Shraddha can be in the mode of goodness or passion or ignorance. Similarly, Lord Krishna explains in this chapter, same chapter, 17th chapter, that the sacrifice one performs can be of three kinds. Either sacrifice in the mode of goodness or passion or ignorance. So in the 12th verse of the 17th chapter, Krishna describes what is the kind of sacrifice that is performed in the mode of passion. Lord Krishna says, Abhisandhayatu phalam dambartham apichaivayat ijjate bharata shreshtha tam yajnam vidhi rajasam. Rajasa Yajna. The translation is, that sacrifice performed for some material benefit or performed ostentatiously out of pride is of the nature of passion. So two specific characteristics of sacrifice offered in the mode of passion is that it is performed for some material benefit. Abhisandhayatu phalam. Or if it is performed dambartham, ostentatiously out of pride, to make a big show, show off, or out of pride, somebody performs a sacrifice. Then such sacrifice is of the nature of passion. So Srila Prabhupada explains in the purport to this verse, sometimes sacrifices and rituals are performed for elevation to the heavenly kingdom or for some material benefits in this world. Such sacrifices or ritualistic performances are considered to be in the mode of passion. So somebody may wonder, what is wrong in performing some sacrifice for elevation to the heavenly planets? If the Vedas state that if you want to elevate yourself to heavenly planets from the earthly planet, you perform this particular sacrifice. The real mystery behind different sacrifices is explained in the Bhagavad Gita in the 4th chapter. Very clearly Krishna says, different types of sacrifices recommended in the Vedas are born of different inclinations to work. I had mentioned this a few days back. Different inclinations to work people have, accordingly they are recommended to do different kinds of sacrifice. But ultimately, all sacrifices are aimed at coming to the status of spiritual knowledge, transcendental knowledge. Sarva karma akhilam partha jnane parisamapit. The sacrifice which is performed in pursuit of transcendental knowledge is considered to be a proper aim for performing sacrifices. That should be the real goal. But there are people who are impelled to perform sacrifice for the sake of some material benefit, or out of pride they want to do sacrifices. So there is a very nice instance in the Srimad Bhagavatam. There was this Prajapati by name Daksha. Prajapati means somebody who is responsible for populating the universe at the beginning of creation. So Daksha was one of the Prajapatis responsible for creating the population, and he was among the many Prajapatis. He was the leader, he was the topmost Prajapati. So once, when there was a great sacrifice organized by the leaders of universal creation, great devatas, great sages, great philosophers, and all varieties of beings from the higher planets, they assembled in this great sacrifice with all their followers. Now, Daksha is the leader of the Prajapati, so his position is a very special position among all the assembled personalities. So when he entered that assembly, his bodily luster was as effulgent as the sun, and the entire assembly was illuminated. So influenced by his bodily luster, all the fire gods and other participants, they stood up out of respect for Daksha. Only two people did not stand up. Who were the two people who did not stand up? Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva. As you might be aware, Lord Brahma is the topmost devata. He is the leader of all the devatas and all the personalities in all the upper planets. And Lord Shiva is even greater than Brahma. He is Mahadeva. Even among devatas, he is the superior to even Brahma. So both these great personalities, Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva, did not stand up. Daksha was adequately welcomed by Lord Brahma, who was the president of the great assembly in that great sacrifice. After offering Brahma Lord, after offering his respects to Lord Brahma, Daksha properly took a seat, being welcomed by Brahma. Before taking his seat, however, he felt very much offended that Lord Shiva was not showing him any respect. Daksha is actually very proud of his position as the leader of the Prajapatis, and he particularly felt very offended that Shiva did not show me any respect. So Daksha became very angry against Lord Shiva, and he began to speak strongly against Shiva's behavior. So he said, "All sages, brahmanas and fire gods present, please hear me with attention. For I speak about the manners of gentle persons. I do not speak out of ignorance or envy. Now Daksha is telling, I am not speaking out of envy, but actually he has become very, very envious of Shiva. That will be revealed in a later part of this narration. He says, Daksha tells the assembly, Shiva has spoiled the name and fame of the governors of the universe and has polluted the path of gentle manners. He is shameless. He does not know how to act. Why is Daksha telling this about Shiva? He justifies. Daksha is telling, Shiva has already accepted himself as my subordinate because he has married my daughter. So, Shiva happens to be the son-in-law of Daksha. So, Daksha thinks Shiva has become subordinate to Daksha. In spite of having this subordinate position, Daksha is telling, Shiva did not stand up to receive me, nor did he think it fit to welcome me with sweet words. And further, Daksha goes on to describe Shiva's manners, which is unacceptable. He lives in filthy places like crematorium. As you all might be aware, Shiva lives in a crematorium. His companions are ghosts and demons. He is like a madman, sometimes laughing, sometimes crying. He smears his body with ashes from the crematorium. He does not bathe regularly. He ornaments his body with a garland of skulls. Therefore, only in name he is called Shiva or auspicious. Actually, he is the most inauspicious person. Therefore, he is very dear to crazy people in the mode of ignorance or tamasic, and he is their leader. Thus, Daksha, seeing Lord Shiva sitting as if Shiva was against him, he washed his hands and mouth and cursed Lord Shiva with the following words. What did he say to curse Shiva? The demigods are eligible to share in the oblation sacrifice, but Lord Shiva, who is the lowest of all demigods, should not have a share in the oblations offered in the sacrifice. Saying this, in spite of the request of all the other members, Daksha, in great anger, after cursing Lord Shiva, left the assembly and went back to his house. Upon understanding Lord Shiva had been cursed, Shiva was accompanied by his associates, Nandishwara, one of the favorite associate of Lord Shiva. Nandishwara became very angry. His eyes became red and he cursed Daksha and all the brahmanas present there who had tolerated Daksha's cursing Shiva in harsh words. When all the hereditary brahmanas, when they were cursed by Nandishwara, the sage Bhrigu, the leader of the brahmanas, he also condemned the followers of Lord Shiva and uttered a brahmanical curse against the followers of Shiva. So when such cursing and counter-cursing was going on, Shiva became very, very unhappy. He didn't say anything. Silently he left the arena of the sacrifice, followed by his disciples. In this manner, there was great tension prevailing between Daksha and Shiva, the father-in-law and the son-in-law, and it continued for some length of time. Lord Brahma, who had appointed Daksha as the chief of all Prajapatis, made Daksha very, very proud, very puffed up. He began another sacrifice after some time, and in that sacrifice also he got full support by Lord Brahma. Then another sacrifice. So the sacrifice that he performed first was called Vajpayee, and the next sacrifice was called Brihaspati Sabha. Now this Brihaspati Sabha sacrifice, when it was organized, it was organized in a very, very grand manner by Daksha. He had invited many, many great Brahmarishis, great sages, great ancestral demigods, and all the other devatas. Along with their family members, they were attending this big sacrifice from different parts of the universe. When Sati, the daughter of Daksha, who was married to Shiva, Sati heard the heavenly inhabitants flying in their airplanes from all directions. They were all talking about the great sacrifice that Daksha has organized, and they were all looking forward to being present in that sacrifice. So they were very nicely dressed up, they had beautiful ornaments, and they are passing near the residence of Lord Shiva, where Sati was staying with Shiva. So when Sati overheard that in her father's place this big sacrifice is going to happen, for which all the devatas along their wives are attending, she became very, very eager to also go for this function. So she addressed Lord Shiva and she told, "Your father-in-law is now executing great sacrifices and all the devatas have been invited. They're all going." So then she suggested to Lord Shiva, "If you so desire, we may also go for the sacrifice." Understanding Shiva's mind, she begged and pleaded with Shiva, "O immortal Lord, please be kind towards me and fulfill my desire. Please show me kindness and accept my request to go for this big sacrificial ceremony." Lord Shiva replied to Sati, his wife. Shiva explained, "One should not go to anyone's house, even on the consideration of his being a relative or a friend, when the person is disturbed in his mind and looks upon the guest with angry eyes. One who is conducted by false ego cannot tolerate the opulence of self-realized souls. He envies them as demons envy the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Certainly, friends and relatives offer mutual greetings by standing up, welcoming one another and offering obeisance. But those who are on the transcendental platform, spiritual platform, those who are self-realized, being intelligent, they offer all respects to the super soul who seated in every body. Without identifying the body with any person." So Shiva is clarifying to Parvati or to Sati that when obeisances are offered to a person, it is not to the body that obeisances are offered. Obeisances are offered to the super soul sitting within the heart of the person. Because the real worshipable, respectable personality is Supreme Lord. And the Supreme Lord is present in everybody as the super soul, as the Paramatma. So he should be offered respect. But externally, one cannot make out what is this offering of respect which is being done. They think it is to the person to whom they are bowing down. So Shiva is explaining that he is a liberated soul therefore he is always engaged in offering respects to the super soul, whom he envisions present everywhere throughout the creation. He has entered into everybody's heart, he has entered into every material atom, he is present everywhere. So Shiva is constantly offering obeisances to the super soul every moment. So where is the question of Shiva not offering obeisances to Daksha when he has already offered obeisances to the super soul sitting within Daksha's heart? So this Daksha could not understand. After all, Daksha is not a self-realized soul. Neither he is free from pride. Therefore, he is very envious. This pride causes envy. He is proud of his position. So he became envious of Daksha. Daksha became envious of Shiva. So Lord Shiva is explaining to his wife Sati, the daughter of Daksha. He is explaining, you should not see your father, although he is the giver of your body, because he and his followers are envious of me. Envious of me means envious of Shiva. In spite of this instruction, if you decide to go, neglecting my words, the future will not be good for you. You are most respectable, but when you are insulted by your father, because he will insult me and thereby insult you also, that insult will be immediately equal to death for you. So Lord Shiva gave his warning and he explained why Sati should not go for that sacrifice being organized by her father. Shiva was silent after speaking in this way, but he could see Sati was really very, very unsettled. She was on the one hand very desirous of going to her father's home to meet all the sisters and to also be part of that grand celebration, that ceremony, amid so many great devatas and great personalities all over the universe were going. At the same time, she was afraid of Shiva's warning. So after dilly-dallying for some time, she finally decided, let me go alone. Looked like Shiva was not going to accompany her. Still, she decided, let me go alone. So she left her husband and began going towards her father's house. Now, when Shiva's disciples, headed by Maniman and Madha, saw Sati leaving alone, they very rapidly followed her with Lord Shiva's bull Nandi in front, accompanied by thousands of yakshas, all Shiva's followers. When Sati with her followers reached the arena of the sacrifice, because all the people had assembled, they were afraid of Daksha. They did not receive her very well. They knew there was tension between Daksha and Shiva. And Shiva's wife has arrived, Sati has arrived. So they dare not displease Daksha. So they did not receive Sati very well. However, Sati's mother, that is Daksha's wife, and Sati's sisters, Daksha's other daughters, they all welcomed her very nicely, spoke to her very pleasingly, and she was in this way led to the area where the sacrificial ceremony was organized. Now, present in the arena of sacrifice, Sati saw there were no oblations being offered to her husband, Lord Shiva. Because this was the curse that Daksha had given to Shiva, that Shiva should not receive any oblations in any sacrifice. So they were not chanting any mantras for offering oblations to Shiva. Neither Daksha had invited Shiva for this sacrifice, nor did he even receive Sati properly. Daksha was so hard-hearted. So This made Sati very angry against her father. Now, seeing Sati becoming so angry, the followers of Lord Shiva, the ghosts, the yakshas, they were ready to do anything to harm Daksha, but Sati stopped them. She was very angry, but in that mood, she began to condemn the process of fruitive sacrificial activities. Fruitive activities means these big sacrifices organized for the sake of some material benefit. And mostly, Daksha was very much proud of his position, and it was more for showing off his great position that he had organized this big sacrifice. So she began to condemn this fruitive sacrificial activities, and she also condemned persons who were very proud of performing such unnecessary sacrifices. So Sati began to defend Lord Shiva. She said, Lord Shiva is the most beloved of all living entities. He has no rival. Nobody is his enemy, nobody is his friend. No one except Daksha could be envious of such a universal being who is free from all enmity. Shiva does not have any inimical feelings towards anybody. But still, why is Daksha so envious of Shiva? Then Sati directly began to condemn Daksha. Twice born Daksha, a man like you can simply find fault in the qualities of others. Lord Shiva never indulges in fault finding with others. If somebody has got a little good quality, he magnifies it and glorifies the person so very nicely. Unfortunately, you have found some fault in such a great personality like Lord Shiva. So then Sati began to tell her father, my dear father, you are committing the greatest offense by envying Shiva. Shiva, the name Shiva, consists of two syllables, Shiva, which means one who is always pure, always auspicious, and he purifies everyone of all sinful activities. Such a pure person, who could envy him except you? Therefore, Sati decided, I shall no longer bear this unworthy body which has been received from you who have blasphemed Lord Shiva. I shall give up my body which has been produced by you. So Sati decided to commit suicide, end her life in that body which was given by her father and mother. Thus, in order to end her life or give up that body, Sati, due to anger towards her father, began to meditate on the fiery air within the body. As you might be aware, inside this body there is a fire. So she began to meditate on that fire within the body. She concentrated all her meditation on the holy lotus feet of Lord Shiva, her husband, and became completely cleansed of all taints of sin. Sati quit her body in a blazing fire by meditation on the fiery elements. When people were talking amongst themselves about the wonderful voluntary death of Sati, the attendants who had come with her readied themselves to kill Daksha, because Daksha was responsible for this whole incident. So when Bhrigu Muni, who was Daksha's priest, among the important priests, the big priest, he saw danger, he began to offer oblations in the sacrificial fire to generate many thousands of Rubu demigods. These Rubu demigods were especially empowered to kill the destroyers of this yajna. So the Rubu demigods directly attacked Shiva's followers, the ghosts, the yakshas. And all these attendants of Sati they began to run away to save their lives in different directions and they disappeared. Then Lord Shiva heard from Narada that Sati was now dead. She was insulted by Daksha, therefore she quit her body. And his soldiers had been driven away by the Ripu demigods. Shiva became very, very angry and he pressed his lips and snatched one strand of hair from his matted locks and he dashed it to the ground and immediately one fearful black demon appeared out of that act of Shiva. This demon was a gigantic personality. He was as bright as three suns in the sky. He had fearful teeth. He had a dangerous looking hair on his head, which were like burning fire. He had thousands of arms and he was equipped with many, many, many very different kind of dangerous weapons. He was garlanded with the heads of skulls. And this dangerous, gigantic black demon with folded hands, he came in front of Shiva. "My dear Lord, what may I do for you?" Shiva ordered him, "You kill Daksha and his followers at this sacrifice." Shiva ordered him, "Kill Daksha." This black gigantic demon, he was named as Veerabhadra. He was the personified anger of the supreme personality of Godhead. So you can imagine how very powerful he was. He was prepared to execute the order of Shiva. He was just waiting for the command. Immediately he rushed with so many other soldiers of Lord Shiva and they all went marching to that sacrificial arena. When the followers of Lord Shiva reached that sacrificial arena of Daksha, then all of them surrounded the sacrificial arena and began to create disturbances. Some of them pulled down the pillars which is supporting the pandal of the sacrifice. Some of them began to destroy the sacrificial arena itself. They broke the pots which were made for use in the sacrifice. Some of them began to extinguish the sacrificial fire. Some blocked the way of the sages who were running away from that dangerous place. Some arrested some devatas. All kinds of commotion. In the middle of this, the chief followers of Shiva, Maniman, one of them, he arrested Bhrigumuni. Veerabhadra arrested Daksha, and Chandesha, another follower of Lord Shiva, he arrested the demigod Pusha. Nandishwara arrested the demigod Bhaga. These were the four topmost personalities in that sacrifice. So there was a continuous shower of stones and all the priests and other members, they were put into immense misery. For fear of their lives, they all started dispersing in different directions. Then Veerabhadra, he tore off the mustache of Bhrigu, he caught hold of Bhaga and plucked out his eyes because Bhaga was moving his eyebrows during Bhrigu's cursing of Shiva. Then Veerabhadra knocked out the teeth of Daksha and he wanted to kill Daksha. So he took one wooden device which was kept for killing animals and he cut off the head of Daksha. Upon seeing this action of Veerabhadra, the party of Lord Shiva became very jubilant and all the brahmanas became very, very morose at the death of Daksha. Then Veerabhadra took the head of Daksha and threw it in the southern side, offering it as an oblation to the sacrificial fire. In this way, the Lord Shiva's followers, they set fire to the whole arena and went back to Kailasa, the abode of Lord Shiva. So you can see how this sacrifice organized by Daksha out of pride. And also, Daksha was, due to pride, he was also envious of Shiva. What was the result of such a sacrifice. It was completely destructive. It was completely destructive. So, the 17th chapter explains one should never perform sacrifice in the mode of passion or ignorance. Sacrifice should be performed in the mode of goodness. So we'll take some questions. What is meant by sadhana dharma? There is no term like sadhana dharma. If you want to know what is sanatana dharma, I may explain that. Or you want to know what is sadhana, bhakti or sadhana. Sadhana means practice. So before we learn how to properly do spiritual practices, we have to go through what is called as sadhana. Sadhana means the practice. So sadhana means practice. And sanatana dharma, if that is the question you are trying to ask, sanatana dharma means eternal religious principles. There is something called swadharma and sanatana dharma. Swadharma is based on our current situation. We have to perform certain duties in accordance with our position. Just like householders have got the duty of taking care of their family members, a brahmachari has got swadharma of doing Vedic studies, or a sannyasi has got swadharma of being renounced and traveling and instructing the common people about religious principles. So like that, swadharma varies from person to person, but sanatana dharma is common for everyone, because ultimately everyone is supposed to perform or practice dharma, perform religious activities or religious, follow religious principles for the sake of ultimate liberation from material bondage. So sanatana dharma is ultimately whatever activity we perform in aimed at pleasing the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Vishnu or Krishna, in order to get out of this material existence. So that is really sanatana dharma. In this yuga, sanatana dharma is practiced by chanting the holy name of the Supreme Lord, Hare Krishna. Another question, if we put too much effort in job, it will affect Krishna conscious duties. If we put less efforts in our job, we may lose the job or may not advance in our career. So how to understand what is the best effort and whether such effort will satisfy the Lord? Now, whenever we do our duties, we should know that all such duties have to be performed as required for the performance of that particular work. It's like somebody is cooking at home. They had to put in all their efforts to cook very nicely with whatever care and caution and skill is required. You have to do your best in whatever you do, duties you do. You cannot compromise or sacrifice thinking that, oh, I have got something else more important to do, so this I can not pay much attention or not be so worried about doing it the best possible manner. No, that is not correct. So really, what is the means of determining how do we save time for actually, if that is the sense in which this question is asked. There's no question of sparing some efforts in order to do one's duties. Every duty has to be performed very nicely to the best of one's ability. But you have to divide your time between your swadharma and sanatana dharma. There are some activities you have to do for maintaining your body, for your obligation towards your family members or towards society. But you also have to spend some time in practicing Sanatana Dharma, which is the ultimate activity meant for our ultimate liberation, which everyone has to do. So you have to divide your time, and in that way you are able to do justice to both Swadharma and Sanatana Dharma. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.